Thank you for being here early in the morning, and we will start the first session in the third day of this fantastic meeting. And the first session will be on multidisciplinary management of high-grade brain EVM, and it is composed of five lectures. And the first one will be endovascular embolization of high spatular Martin grade EVM, when and how, presented by Professor Michel Piotin. Professor Michel Piotin, he is one of the most expert interventional neuroradiology, and he is working in Paris. Please, Dr. Michel.
Okay. Thank you. So first of all, I want to thank the organizing committee and specifically Luca for this kind invitation. So I'm going to address a very difficult topic. It's a rare disease. It's even rarer for high-grade AVM. This is my disclosure. So AVMs, as you probably already know, are rare disease. The incidence is maximum one per 100,000 inhabitants per year. Hemorrhage is the most common presentation for AVM, followed by seizure, headache, and progressive focal neurological deficits. The majority of hemorrhagic stroke in childhood are due to AVM. The vast majority of AVM are diagnosed under the age of 40, and there is a substantial cumulative risk over the lifespan of a patient harboring an AVM. But high-grade AVM, referring to Spetzler 4 and 5, is only 10 to 20% of all AVM. And specifically in our series, when we look back to our database based on more than 1,300 patients, going to our clinic for consultation and treatment, we have overall of 19% of high-grade AVM only. The mode of discovery, as you can see, is various, but hemorrhage is still the most predominant way of discovery. But as you can see, progressive neurological deficit is more than 20% of the case. And you can see that the incidental discovery, conversely to small grade AVM, is very low. So, as you probably already know, there is different ways, and in the majority of cases, combination of treatment, including endovascular treatment, surgical excision, and radiosurgery. And you can combine these three modalities to cure the patients. Let's have a look to the so-called Spetzler and Martin classification. It's a surgical classification determine what are the risk of surgical excision. But in fact, I think it's quite well adapted to endovascular treatment. And high-grade AVMs, I repeat, refers to grade 4 and 5. So in the vast majority of cases, all grade 4 and specifically more, even more, the 5 are nearly all eloquent. In our database, more than 90% of high-grade AVM are in keeping with location in eloquent areas. Which is very important also is to look for the deep venous drainage for the classification. So when to treat by endovascular treatment, by embolization, high-grade AVM? Unruptured case? Probably not. Certainly not anymore. And we do advocate surveillance. We have a small clue to propose an endovascular treatment for high-grade EVM for fortuitous discovery. We have only now the Aruba study. It's a very bad study, but at least it's a study which is randomized. And at least on a legal perspective, this is a very powerful study. So take care of high-grade asymptomatic AVM. Probably do not touch them. Rupture AVM is different, but you have to place in perspective the cumulative risk of re-hemorrhage with the risk of your procedural complication. What is the goal of the treatment of an AVM, generally speaking? To reduce the risk of bleeding, yes, for sure. What are the predictive factors of bleeding from an AVM? Previous bleeding is very important, according to the Toronto team. Associated pedicular aneurysm or intranodal aneurysm, and also deep venous drainage. When you look at the series of staff and collaborators, that's the New York series, the predictive factor of AVM is previous bleeding as well, deep venous drainage, and deep location. When you combine the two, you see you have a common target. It is previous bleeding and deep venous drainage that are a clue to advocate for treatment. Overall, in case of unruptured AVM, the annual risk of bleeding is 1% if both factors, meaning deep brain vein and associated aneurysm, are absent, 3% if one factor is present, and 8% if both factors, deep venous drainage and associated aneurysm, are present. But for rupture AVM, the landscape is totally different. The annual risk of bleeding is 5% if both present are absent, up to 15% if only one factor is present, and up to 35% if both factors are present in the AVM. First conclusion, the risk of bleeding is low when the AVM is previously unruptured, is cortically located versus deeply located, with cortical draining vein without deep venous drainage, and regardless of the needle volume. High-grade AVM, large nidus size, also bleed, because it was said previously that we have better chance of bleeding when the aneurysm is small. I don't believe to that. It is good to propose endovascular treatment to reduce the risk of seizures. We should know that it is not true. When you look at this paper published in 2002, it is issued from the Scottish Registry of Brain AVM. They made a prospective study on 229 adults in two arms. They give treatment to the patient in 154 patients versus 75 left untreated. And they follow them for 2 years. And you can see that there is no difference in between two arms. So the chance of achieving a two-year seizure freedom is similar in both groups if you treat versus if you only surveil the patient. Another conclusion, seizure cure is not the goal of AVM treatment. But only complete AVM occlusion from the circulation is going to protect the patient from bleeding or further bleeding. And when starting to treat an AVM, whatever the treatment modality, a partial occlusion does not reduce the risk of hemorrhage. So when to treat high-grade AVM by embolization? Unrupture, seizure, yes, again, no evidence, no definitive proof to consider endovascular treatment. About palliative embolization. Palliative embolization in case of chronic vascular steal, venous hyperpressure, leading to the patient to progressive neurological deficits. This is still controversial. It may increase also the risk of hemorrhage. From a Japanese series from Miyamoto and collaborators, they found that the fact that you propose to make partial embolization will even increase the risk of further hemorrhage. Conversely, Mike Alexander and collaborators make a publication and matched two groups of AVM. And they show that when you propose a partial treatment by embolization, you may reduce the risk of adverse event, hemorrhage, seizures. To illustrate the case of chronic vascular steal and venous hyperpressure, I've got this to propose you to review this recent case. This is a story of a young man. He's 28. He has epilepsy for 25 years. He had a surgical intervention, encephalo-duro-arteriosynososis, at the age of 8. He was still autonomous until 26, despite he was MRS2 with right hemiparesis. But within 2 years, he degraded progressively until tetraparesia, aphasia, swallowing difficulty, dyspnea, and cognitive impairment. He was bedridden. This is a fast contrast MRI just before the treatment. As you can see, we have a huge AVM, but the AVM, the nidus, is not too much a problem here to my sense. The problem is the venous engorgement. So you can see even that we have a posterior fossa drainage leading to an engorgement of perimedullary veins. And we thought that was the cause of the swallowing problem of the patient. So we decided to go for treatment after a long consultation with the family and to propose to have a partial reduction of the AVM to reduce the flow into the veins. And you can see on the MRI that we have a very big venous engorgement, and you can see the lacie of veins in the posterior fossa compressing the medulla. This is the first EMBO in February this year. So we made, you can see that the venous drainage along the spinal cord at the cervical level. We decided to go for embolization, and I think we did 5 shots of glue. We even used coils in some instance to get rid of high flow of fistula. You can see that bad, we have a venous passage of MBCA in the straight sinus here. And we were able to reduce, you can see we use also proximally coils to reduce big avations. And we went for a second EMBO in March, 2 months later, to keep on with a reduction of the volume of the AVM, but more specifically to reduce the venous hyperpressure. We were able to have a nice result in terms of volume reduction. This is the end. After 2 EMBO sessions, the patient was really improved. He was able to walk with crutches and have a good improvement in cognitive problem. But 3 months later, after the second EMBO, he had again a degradation on a cognitive aspect, in leading to thrombosis of the left transverse sinus. As you can see, the left transverse sinus is thrombosed, but we conducted a third session of embolization. We put the patient under NOAC and proposed a third embolization to get rid of the venous hyperpressure. And you can see the MRI scan before the first EMBO session and after the third EMBO session. You can see we have a diminution of the venous engorgement, the transmedullary veins are less apparent, and specifically on the posterior fossa, the draining vein impinging the medulla oblongata is no longer opacified. This is the PCA MRA before and after the 3 EMBO session. As you can see, the AVM is still there, but we have a tremendous diminution of the venous engorgement of the brain. What about curative embolization in high-grade AVM? When you look at the literature, the people achieve 10 to 50% of cure, angiographic cure of the AVM. But recently, in very highly selected patients, small series, the number is approaching 90%. We have a recent paper from Loisif and collaborators. In a series of 20-something AVM, they were able to get 90% of total cure of embolization. But again, that very selected series. This is a case to illustrate the cure of Spessler-Martin grade 4 patient. It was a 22-year-old boy with putaminal and insular hematoma. He was MRS3 after 1 month after the MRI, and this is a 3D angio of the AVM. So the plan was to conduct a different session, 3 sessions of embolization by arterial route, using a magic microcatheter to deliver glue through lenticulostriate artery. We use often a balloon catheter also to shoulder the navigation, to help the navigation of the lenticulostriate artery. And after 3 sessions, we were able to have a nice reduction, see the cast of glue, and we still have a remnant as a superior posterior aspect of the AVM with a single drilling vein. So we decided with the family that we are going to conclude the session by a 4 session using a venous approach through the thalamocerebral vein and internal cerebral vein, using a distal access catheter through the right jugular, and navigate the catheter inside the nidus. We also use a small catheter, magic catheter, on the arterial aspect to make a roadmap of the remnant of the EVM, and we were able to finish the EVM. This is the end of the procedure. This is the angio. Patient seems to cure, and most of it at 1 year and a half, we have a good follow-up. The EVM is still a cure, and the patient improves his back to college without the help of coaches. About our personal series about audiographic cure, we have to be quite modest because we are able to attain a total cure only by EVT in 57% in grade 4 and only 50% in grade 5. What are the procedural risks of endovascular treatment of high-grade EVM? When you look at this meta-analysis, this paper, you look like when you used not for 4 to 5, but 3 to 5 EVM, the odds of complication due to treatment, period operative complication, is 11-fold more than a small EVM, grade 1 or grade 2. So big EVM, you should consider you have a greater risk, a far greater risk of complication. This is our personal series about mortality and morbidity with complication during the 4 weeks after treatment. We have 1% mortality for grade 4 with 19 permanent disability and 5% of mortality for grade 5 with 21% of permanent disability. This is very high. What about this kind of complication? Are they bleeding more than the other, or is it more on the ischemic aspect? It seems that when we look back from our series, that we have no correlation in between the hemorrhagic complication and the spacer grade. We have the same rate of complication, of hemorrhagic complication in small EVM than in large EVM. So we have more complication in high-grade EVM, probably also due to ischemic insult to the brain. It's an example again of very eloquent area, rupture AVM. It's a grade 4 because the nidus is 30 millimeter or something. And we were able to cure the patient in one session. Sometimes we succeed using the so-called pressure cooker technique, using two microcatheters in the same pedicle, closing the pedicle relatively proximally with coils, and then after injecting a squid or onyx downstream in the current of the blood flow, and after two catheterization in the same session, we were able to get rid of this frontal AVM. You see, this is relatively large, deeply penetrating the white matter with superficial cortical drainage, but also deep vein drainage on the frontal view. Another case of parieto occipital AVM, rupture case. As you can see here, and you have to take notice of that, this is AVM which is using two vascular territories, the MCA territory and also the PCA territories. There is a deep venous drainage, there is the venous ectasia. We decided to go for treatment using two microcatheters, two detachable tip microcatheters, one from the PCA, one from the left MCA. We started by embolization by the superior catheter into the MCA territory. But as you can see, we get a problem here. We have early venous occlusion. This is a venous passage squid. So you can see that the problem here it will be probably potential hemorrhage. The patient is in trouble because at the end of this embolization, you still have some peripheral remnant of the EVM, but there is no more venous drainage. So it's very urgent to finish up the embolization. We use the second catheter placed into the distal PCA to inject NBCA and to finish up the perinidal aspect of this AVM. So we are happy. We get full devascularization at the end of the embo. There is no more AVM, but still at day one, the patient sustained an hemorrhage with another hematoma into the parietal lobe. So in conclusion, high-grade AVM remains very challenging to manage by endovascular treatment alone, despite refined technique like pressure cooker technique, despite the venous retrograde approach. And this type of AVM, like all other brain AVM, has to be taken in a multidisciplinary approach, and with a case-by-case decision-making process. Thank you.